Waiting
longer than usual. Waiting. There it is. Hey, good morning, mediums. It's March 20th, 2017. Welcome to another episode of Live here on Keystroke Medium. It is season 2, episode 23. I am Josh Hayes here with my co-host Scott Moon. And today we are talking with science fiction author Terry Mixon about his Empire of Bones saga and his most recently, his post-apocalyptic novel, The Scorched Earth. Terry, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me on, and may I congratulate you on your pronunciation of apocalyptic.
Apocalyptic.
It is. Apocalyptic. We should probably all say it really quickly.
You know, it's funny because every time I have a word like that before we hit broadcast, I'm like, okay, I'm going to say it correctly. I'll screw it up every time, most of the time.
I used pedagogical in a presentation at work one time and got rave reviews.
Rave reviews.
Figure out how to pronounce that.
Your vernacular is impressive, Scott. I'm just going to say it right now. I'm just saying it. For those of you that don't know, Terry is also a podcaster, which is why he's got the uber cool setup, and his sound quality is fantastic. What's your co-host name?
Paul Cooley.
Paul Cooley, that's right. They host the Dead Robot Society podcast, which is also a writing-based podcast, and they have been going strong for 10 years now. Is that right?
It'll be 10 years later this year, like August, I think it is. August 9th.
Insane. So Scott and I are the rookies for this show. And okay, Terry, take it away. I would like to talk about the podcast a little bit later on in the show. But for our audience members who are unfamiliar with you and your writing, can you tell us a little bit about how you got started?
Sure. I'm actually not one of those people that always knew he was going to be a writer. I've just been one of those folks that reads everything that they can get their hands on, science fiction, mystery, adventure, thrillers, that kind of thing. And about 7 years ago, one of my friends sent me a manuscript and said, here's my novel. And I said, well, damn it, I could do that. So I started learning what I needed to do to write, and I've moved into doing that now, and I'm actually been making a living off of it full time for 2 years. So I apparently don't suck too badly.
That's fantastic.
I like that. I don't suck.
Don't suck too much. Just enough.
So you are an indie published writer. Did you start out when you started out writing? First of all, what led you to want to do this as a career, and what led you to choose indie publishing over traditional?
I chose indie publishing because it's easier to start with, easier access to actually get my work out there. When I started buying the books on writing that I was educating myself with, I thought I was going to have to go through traditional. And I used the books as a crutch rather than writing. I'd read about writing. And so I fell into that trap.
Yep,
and finally dug myself out. As far as why I started doing it, that's a really great question. I'm not sure what the original impetus was to start being a writer, was thinking that I was going to actually be successful at it. In fact, I'm not actually sure that I thought I was going to be successful at it when I started.
I think it's strange that in our line of, if you want to call it work or our chosen art form, so many people start out not knowing if they're going to be successful, but then a lot of people still carry on even not being successful.
Well, most people should, you know, if you're going to be a writer, you should probably start off with assuming you're not going to be successful, because there's like 15 billion of us, and it depends on your definition of success, you know,
right.
What I wanted to really know about is, because you talked about being an avid reader and stuff. And to me, coming into writing from being a huge reader is maybe the best, most purest way to be a writer. And so I'm curious about what types of things you were reading that made you love the genre so much or the medium and start doing it.
For science fiction, it's old school stuff. E.E. Doc Smith, the Heinlein children's novels, books along those are what I grew up reading. And I think that's actually what led me to be a writer, is because a lot of the novels that I've been reading recently just don't measure up to that. And I wanted to hear a different story. So I said, if I want to hear it, I'm going to have to actually write it myself. I think that may be what did it.
Your your Empire of Bone saga is a military science fiction, and you have some history in the military. Is that what kind of led you to write that fiction, or did you?
No, I it helped a little bit. It helps with the mindset, although serving in the Army back in the 1980s is not much of a help for modern military action, because that's not quite how things work anymore. Things get dated very quickly, but you get the mindset of what military people think like, mm-hmm. and that gives you a leg up in being able to at least write a believable military person. I read authors like David Weber and John Ringo and a number of other military science fiction authors, and those folks inspire me to write more military science fiction. That's what made me choose that.
Your characters, and I've read the first book of your Empire of Bones saga, which is actually titled Empire of Bones, and the you write military science fiction, but some of the characters are not military. Mm-hmm. They're civilian, and they're in the power hierarchy, if you want to call it, with the princess there and the emperor and all that stuff. But what led you, a lot of military science fiction writers tend to focus specifically on leaving it in the military realm when you talk about having characters and the plots and all that. What led you to bring in a non-military character into that world, into your story?
Well, actually, Princess Kelsey was the reason that the novel got written in the first place. I consider her my main character, as opposed to her half-brother, Jared, who's the military commander.
Right.
And what happens to her in that book, she's the main character because she's the one that has the biggest change from beginning to end. Mm-hmm. The place where she leaves that book is definitely a lot different than where she begins it. And I've always been a big fan of strong female characters, and that's what I wanted to portray. And I envision the characters almost before I come up with the plots that they have. I'm a pantser, so I've got a character. I say, I want this kind of thing to happen with them. Here's where I start them, and then I just start making things up as I go.
I'm curious, and I will talk a lot about this more when we get later into the program about the craft and the aspect of actually writing the books and planning them out. So I'll leave this question till later, but can you give our, since we're going to be talking about this series, basing a lot of our discussion around it, can you tell a little bit about our audience, a little bit about maybe just the first book or what they're looking at story-wise?
The setting that the novels take place in is a far future date in which there had been a grand Terran Empire that occupied an incredible number of star systems. About 500 years in the past, before the first novel, there was a great civil war that basically destroyed the empire and left the people that the heroes come from trapped on a single planet. They've only just begun expanding back into space, and they're starting to explore, trying to find the remnants of the Terran Empire, because they don't even have any maps left. Their world was trashed with EMPs. They lost all of their recorded data. They've had to just basically bootstrap themselves back up. So this is a grand exploration novel looking into basically the bones of the empire and finding things that they never expected to find. And it's still happening. Even I'm writing book 7 now, and they're still finding things that they had no idea existed.
And can you talk a little bit about the inspiration? Like, where did you pull the idea from? And did you pull it from, you mentioned David Weber and John Ringo. Did you pull aspects of those kind of storytellings to write this series?
I am certain that I pulled pieces of it from all over the place, but I can't actually tell you where the general idea came from. I had when I started writing this novel, all I had in mind was the end result of what was going to happen to Princess Kelsey. So I was writing towards that goal from the very beginning of the novel, and basically making it up with whatever sounded adventurous and exciting along the way.
Oh, interesting. Kind of sounds like you didn't intentionally set out to write military sci-fi. That was just the shell of the story, or?
I would have, when I started writing this, I would have labeled it space opera as opposed to military science fiction. I knew that it was going to have a strong military element, but I think that calling it military science fiction is more marketing rather than writing.
I could see that.
The line there is not always that clear. A lot of writers straddle it, jumping back and forth, you know, pretty freely.
Yeah, I agree with that. And I think, though, that there is, like, when you look at his books, specifically the first one, you can definitely tell where the line is. I mean, it's based on a military starship, and it has military tactics and military rank structure and all that kind of stuff. And general space opera, I think that's not based in military, doesn't have that.
Well, the premise as you described it, first of all, I think that's awesome. And then so my next question is always going to be, is there an audiobook version of these?
The first four books have the audio version out. Good and deal. Book five is under work right now.
That's fantastic. And so one of my favorite questions, I got to say two things. First of all, Vicky Malone Kennedy loves your Death Star, Mike. chat box there. I was like, it does kind of look a little bit like a Death Star.
I'm curious to where the exhaust ports are.
Right, exactly. It's back here in the back. Zoom in. There's a huge little battle going on in the Death Star right now.
That's right. So,
I'll ask two questions. Vicky Malone wants to know if you're influenced by the original Star Wars, and then if we remember, we'll come back to my favorite question. We'll ask that one next about some character stuff. So,
Of course, I'm influenced by Star Wars. I mean, that came out what, 1977? I think it was the first one, or late 70s.
Yeah.
I was in high school when that came out, and I remembered it was a huge influence on what I liked about science fiction, and I've never gotten over it. I'd already been a fan of adventure stories set in science fiction before that, but that gave me a visual reference. And so, of course, that's...
Do you have any annoying friends or family members who have never seen Star Wars?
I don't think so. I think everybody's seen it. Surely everyone has seen it.
No, it's not true. I keep finding them. It's weird.
We're not talking about the prequels now. We're not talking about the prequels.
My wife has never seen Star Wars.
Talking about the first one, episode four. Right.
No, my wife has never seen any of the Star Wars movies, and she refuses to watch any of the Star Wars movies.
I have a brother-in-law who's extremely talented in other types of creative fields, but he loves Jaws. It's his favorite movie ever, and he will not watch Star Wars because Star Wars knocked Jaws off the number one slot in the theaters. And to this day, he has not seen Star Wars. So you got to admire his determination and dedication.
You've got to bring that into a military science fiction thing by saying, I think I need a bigger starship.
I think I need a bigger starship.
I need a bigger starship.
Exactly. And maybe a Sharknado or some sort of military sci-fi shark sci-fi right there.
Sharknado wormhole in hyperspace.
Sharknado is proof that no matter how crazy your ideas are, it might work.
Can work. It's all in the execution. So my favorite question that I ask, and I haven't asked it for a couple episodes, so I'm kind of jonesing. Josh Barr knows where I'm going with this. And it's about characters, because you're a pantser, you like your characters. So do you have a favorite non-lead character to write? Like, not your main protagonist, but one that's like a second or some sort of other character that is just really a blast to write?
Yes, I have a scientist who is basically a late teenager. He's brilliant. He's a geek. And the things he does with science, just, I get to use him as my tool to do crazy things, like use technology to recreate Thor's hammer. Things that's like cool. That.
Yeah, that's my type of geek scientist right there. Thor's hammer. I like that question because everybody we've asked that question to always has a non-primary character who's just really fun. And I wonder why that is. That's in the mind of the writer, or if it's just, I don't know, there's always somebody. So I find that fascinating. So
there's no telling. I know that I like that secondary character because I get to let him be my outlet for my crazy.
There you go. See, maybe that's the secret.
My favorite
secondary character is always a strong female character. So I'm not sure what that means, but
nothing wrong with that at all, man.
Good time. So anyway, Josh, I interrupted you for like the eighth time. So
no, you're
good,
dude.
I'll shut up. I'll hide behind my coffee cup.
No, it's all right. The story that you've written, it tends to not include a lot of the popular tropes that are going around in military sci-fi or space opera. Just recently, in the last couple of years, there's a lot of huge, way powerful alien races that are invading, and we're the last starship to help, and you know, all these kind of different tropes, which I found very refreshing. I also found the claustrophobicness of the ship, the setting, very well done in the way that you presented the material. Was this a conscious effort by you to not follow along with those type of tropes and kind of create the atmosphere that was kind of like a submarine-ish type atmosphere?
I don't know that I was trying to create a submarine type atmosphere, but I did, when I was growing up, read a lot of World War II submarine novels as far as, you know, actual historical stuff. There's a book called Warfish by Gradell that was written, gosh, I want to say in the late 50s, that still I have a copy on my bookshelf today, that it's an excellent book that's written in a fictional perspective about somebody that actually served in the World War II submarine corps. And it's had an impact, sure. And I would say that it definitely had part of the influence on it. As far as humans versus aliens, I think when I started reading science fiction, it was all about the human condition. It was the enemies were humans, the good guys were humans. And that's still got an influence on me. I don't know that I have some aliens in mind, but I don't know that they'll ever be a huge impact into the story, because I think the human condition is more interesting to the readers.
I agree.
Lauren Moore asks, she says, do you find it easy to create distinct character voices? Why? If not, how do you make them more unique? And I can repeat that if I talk too fast.
Sure. I don't know that I find it easy, because I'm a pantser. The way that I normally write my novels is I actually use Dragon Naturally Speaking. So I'm dictating the novel. So I'm actually getting the character voices in my head as I'm doing it. Even when I'm writing with the keyboard, it's like I'm just watching a TV screen inside my head and typing out what they say. And as a book goes along, as a character's been there longer, it's like a film negative. They develop more. They develop their own personality, their own quirks. I often have to go back to the beginning of the book when I'm finished with it and go back through it so that I can add their personality in that they've developed by the end of it.
Yeah.
So sure, you have to develop those personalities, and it happens for each character. I can't say that I have a process for it. It just happens. I was a role player in any number of different games for decades, and that has definitely helped my storytelling, because you basically have to make up a person every time you play.
It's kind of like creating a character in a RPG, like you were saying, you know, you spend a lot of time, if you play MMORPGs, which I have in the past, creating a character avatar or something, and you make them unique, or you want to do something unique about them. So I like that. That's cool.
I like the characters developing kind of organically. And I really like great characters. You know, I'm a huge Stephen King fan, and a big part of his thing, and that's why he kind of goes off in the weeds a lot of times, is he goes off on some character's story that really has nothing to do with anything, and he managed to make it work because people keep reading.
The interesting thing about developing a character, though, is you may think you know where the story is going, and then you come to a point in the story where this person would not do what you want them to do. The story is going to take a left-hand turn, because you're not going to force the character to do something that's against their nature. You're going to have to adjust what story you thought you were telling and see where you're going.
Yeah.
That's interesting to me that you say that, because you say that you're a pantser, but you have, you say you were just finishing the seventh novel in this series. Mm-hmm. The sixth one's out and you're finishing the seventh one.
I've got 10 books published in 4 different series. So this is number 11 that I'm working on, seventh in the series.
Okay. With that in mind, being a pantser, how have you been able to keep a series scope or a series arc, and how do you go about planning or pantsing the novels, knowing where you're going for the next book in the series?
The key to making an open-ended series, I think, is to have the setting be large enough to where you're not going to run out of space for the characters to roam around in. It's when I start, I'll set up what I think the end game is going to be way, way, way down the line. And then I just take the first segment of the story and say, here's the first mile of the journey and the first major obstacle that they're going to have to face getting towards that. And that's the first novel. And that's what I write it on. But I keep in mind that there are themes that have to go through multiple books, things that may happen in the first couple that are going to actually bear fruit later on. And so it's a challenge sometimes because I should write them down, but they're in my head.
Do you think that's why my fantasy is always such huge books and stuff? Because they have like these worlds that they can wander around in, and because you can just be expansive and have a large cast of characters, have a Game of Thrones or a Brandon Sanderson type of thing where the story can keep going with some consistency.
I just read that Brandon Sanderson's next novel is going to have 500,000 words. That's a lot of words. I don't know if it's the scope of the world that makes it that large. I think it may be fantasy. A lot of the authors like delving into the details. They want to explain all the different details of the world and how it's different from ours. Mm-hmm. So I really don't know if that's what makes them doorstops.
It depends. Well, and that depends. And that's what people seem to want in that genre, those things. We have a couple of questions, Josh. Do you want to hit any of those?
I just want to hit really quickly on the series. Right now, The Stormlord Archive by Sanderson is sitting at 782,000 words. The first novel, Way of Kings, is 384,000. The second novel is 398,000. And then Oathbringer, like he said, is going to be close to 500,000. And it's interesting that when you read them, because they don't, sometimes it feels like they're that long, but sometimes it doesn't. Yeah. And I don't know how he manages to do that, but because I listen to him on audiobook, so it's, I have a set number of hours that I have already known.
Yeah.
So like the second book was 49 hours long. And
wow.
Yeah. And I even listened to it at 1.25 speed and it still takes forever. But I don't feel like listening to the books. I don't feel like they drag out. Like you listen, you read some people that will use three pages to describe a room, and he doesn't do that. He's very sparse in his thing. So it's the large word counts. I know he's a planner, but still that's a lot of words to dedicate to one book.
Okay. Maybe it's because of how the time frame that I grew up. I'm over 50 now. So I definitely grew up during a certain book size being the natural length. So my books end up being, the earliest ones were in the 70,000 range, mm-hmm. and now they're up to the 85, 90,000 range. And that feels very natural to me. Maybe it depends on what you read when you were forming your reading habits.
I think it also goes to the genre as well. I mean, you read Martin's books and they're around the same length. And a lot of other epic fantasy is around the same length. But when you talk about science fiction, typically science fiction and military science fiction are the length that you're talking about, 80 to 90,000 words, unless you're talking about Hamilton.
Unless you're Peter
and then
Hamilton.
You can throw that right out of the window and write a million words for a trilogy, which is ridiculous to me. Yeah. But yeah, we can hit the questions here. Let's see. The first one I think that we didn't cover yet is from Vicky. Hi, Vicky. How are you? She says, I love the movie In His Mind anthology. I do that too. Does he create some of these stories and characters in his dreams? Ask if he creates some of these stories and characters in his dreams or from his dreams.
I've got a notepad that sits by my bed. And if an idea pops into me, usually not when I'm dreaming, usually right as I'm trying to fall asleep, I'll jot out a note for it. And then hope that in the morning it makes any kind of sense at all. There have been a few times where I've read my note and said, I have no idea what I meant.
Yeah, I do the same thing. A lot of times I'll fall into the, I wake up and have a fantastic idea and then be like, that is so good, I'm going to remember it when I wake up. And then I have no idea what the idea was.
I like those ideas. You're like, this is the most brilliant thing ever. And then you look at it later, like, that's dumb.
Yeah.
I remember... One of my heroes as far as writing, Christine Catherine Rush, told me once that she makes notes the same way. And she had one on her desk that she tried to, it said, "Zombies are dead." That's all the note said. She has no idea what it meant.
Good, good job. Gold star for Captain.
Which is actually false because zombies are undead.
Oh, there you go.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. The next question we have on the lineup from Preston Lay. What's up, Preston? Can he explain about how the character does something he doesn't plan and it changes the story? Preston says he never understood how the characters can change what you have planned. So maybe you can elaborate a little bit on that.
You may have a certain plot event that you want to do, and you get to it with a character, and you suddenly realize that based on their moral nature, that is something that they wouldn't do. Something that they could not do and still be the same person that you've already developed them as being. It's hard to explain, but if you're actually holding this as a character, as a person in your mind, if you know your friends, you know that there are some things that if a certain set of circumstances come up, they're going to do something, or that they would not do something. And if you try to say that a character would do course A, when it's become apparent through the actions and the beliefs of this character that there's no way in hell that would happen, you're going to have to change course. Right. It doesn't happen often, but it does happen.
It can happen. I have an example that's not a bad example of that, where I had some characters. I have these twins, and it's a boy and a girl, and they're twins, and they go along, and they're not really the main characters, but and so there's some scenes where they're supposed to kind of like really be like really close, and they get along and they kind of agree on everything. But as I'm writing the story, every time I have dialogue with them, they're always fighting, even though they're twins. And so I get to that key scene that I planned out, and they're supposed to like just kind of be like really in tune and kind of like almost, you know, like they never disagree. But it's clear to anybody who's been reading that that's not going to work any longer. And so I have to change what happens there just because I don't know why they argued, but I didn't plan on them being so argumentative, but they're just unruly.
So, Settle down and do what I tell you to do.
Yeah.
Or I'm turning this car right around.
Yeah. So it would feel false. It goes to your sensitivity to your character and how sensitive you are to that character. When you realize that's a false, that would be false to the character, and it would not make sense.
Right.
If you change what a character behaves like, the readers are going to see it because they're following along with this person as a person. And if it does something that they can't believe, it's going to knock them out of the story.
And they'll be mad, especially if it's their favorite character and they suddenly does do something that they wouldn't do.
So, yeah, I agree. Lauren Moore asks, in reference to when we were talking about your mention of the human condition and how it affects conflict and plot. She's wondering if you've given any thought or attention to the alien condition, what it is and what it might do to affect the story or stories.
I have given a little bit of consideration to it, but since I only have very few aliens in my universe, it's not been a big driver. I've introduced an alien species in the book that I'm writing now that's going to take on a larger role in the future. And I've actually been thinking about that exact thing of how I can make them an individual group of people that aren't just humans with their faces painted blue.
That makes sense. I think a lot of people, when you talk about their faces painting blue, that brings up another question to me when you talk about creating this character.
It's blue-faced people because I think that'd be cool.
No, I like it.
Painting my face blue after the show's over, you will never know.
I think we should do TNO with blue faces.
Go pink.
There you go.
Oh, no. It'd be KU blue, and that's the end of the story. when you talk about creating the aliens and talking about their condition and then the way they look and the way they live, do you think about the geographical aspects that have made them that way and have created a blue skinned alien? Do you look in the science of that, or you just go, okay, hand wave them. This is more science fantasy and it's not really integral to the plot. And you just say they have 8 tentacle arms and blue skin just because I say it.
I'd say I would look a little bit at the scientific background of how it might be possible to do it. But I think the character was the race would develop more along the lines of what best is suited for the story. And maybe more on what their psychological makeup is and how aspects of it will be not only alien, but incomprehensible to us. That's what I'm going to find challenging to write, is figuring out what parts are non-human and trying to make them feel realistic.
Yeah, no, I like that. That makes sense. Preston Lay asks, do you read in the same genre that you write in while you're writing in that genre? And if so, how do you keep the stories that you're reading from bleeding into your own work?
I do, and sometimes I don't. Sometimes as a reader, you're going to see something and go, I like that theme. You're not going to steal, you know, something concrete from somebody's story, but you can be influenced by some theme or some series of events and go, I'm inspired. I need to do something similar or build upon something like that. And that happens all the time in writing. There is nothing that is new in writing. Everybody is riffing off of everybody else. You've just got to keep, you know, from stealing somebody else's details. Be inspired. Just don't take, if that makes any sense.
No, I like that a lot.
You name your characters Harry Bosch.
Well, sure. Yes.
Why not? I don't know if there's any other Michael Connelly fans in there.
The next novel I write, I'm just going to take all the names of the guests that we've had on the show and use them.
It's going to be some good names.
You should make a graveyard of all the people that have been on the show.
Yeah, everybody's getting redshirted in this.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody.
It's the Keith Medium redshirt novel.
Earlier we were talking about, I'm kind of going off tracks here, but we were talking about the length of, say, Brandon Sanderson or George R. R. Martin. But what about, like, Elmore Leonard? Because I'm a huge Elmore Leonard fan. Now, his books are very short. Mm-hmm. Do you ever read anything like that, or in different – you read different genres, I'm assuming.
I do read different genres. A lot of the, like, the stuff I was talking about, E.E. Doc Smith earlier, he wrote his stuff back in the 20s and 30s, if I remember correctly. And his were very short, like that 40, 50,000 word novels, because that's the way that it used to be. And so I've read stuff that's that way and I enjoy it. I just want to add a little bit more character spice, add a little bit of expansive space and exploration to mine. So I could write something that short and I enjoy it, but I don't.
I love fantasy because I like one. It depends on what genre I'm in. Some were like fantasy. I like to go there because I want to go live in the story world. I don't really, you know, like go live in Middle Earth, or although going to George R. R. Martin's story world is kind of a dangerous place to go. But you know, I want to, you know, I like, that's why I think I like to have them be so big. I like Elmore Leonard because it's so punchy and intense and fast, and like he's famous for saying just leave out the boring parts. And he will do things like he won't explain stuff at all. I mean, if the character wouldn't have it explained to him in the book, he will not explain it. And I've done that a few times in fantasy and science fiction, and it can be kind of jarring to a fantasy or science fiction writer that expects stuff to be explained.
Tastes change over time.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think too, though, and Preston's brought up a good point in the chat. I'm going to incorporate into what I'm saying here. Science fiction and fantasy, when you're talking about Elmore Leonard not explaining anything, I think you can do that a little bit more in fantasy because you have magic and you have he did this with his magic. And you're like, okay, that makes sense. Whereas in science fiction, you said he did this with his hyperdrive or whatever. And there's common knowledge when it comes to hyperdrive or hyperspace or warp or faster than light travel. So if you're trying to do something in science fiction that is completely like, you know, he's going faster than light, but he's not in hyperspace, or you're not explaining it to somebody, the readers of science fiction are going to want to know, even if it's just a paragraph of hand wavium, what is going on with, you know, are you bending space time? Are you using a wormhole generator? Like, what are you doing? Like, it's still hand wavium, but they're still going to want a little bit of.
People want the rules of the rules of the story world.
And so, like, with Preston's comment here, and he says, I'm going to murder this last name, Ian Tregillis I guess Preston interviewed him yesterday on his show, The Legendarian, which is a fantastic show, 30-minute author interviews. Mm-hmm. Ian says that magic is very convenient rug for sweeping leaves underneath. The trick is sweeping all the inconvenient questions under the rug and then finding a way to very subtly nail down the rug so the readers can't pry it up later, which I think is magic and fantasy, and then hand-waving in science fiction.
Tropes in science fiction and tropes in fantasy worlds are great shortcuts that'll cover a lot of ground for the reader, because you have a lot of leeway in not explaining how the specifics of something works if you use a trope, whether it's hyperdrive, whether it's warp space, whether it's stargates, whether it's my fireball, my magic, my whatever. You can get away with not having to explain specifics that might jar the reader by using those tropes. But like you said, when you get into a place where you're trying to do something that the tropes don't cover, you've got to at least nail down enough details to where they don't go, what?
Right.
So what's your favorite way to do that in an entertaining manner?
I usually have the scientists screw something up terribly.
Oh yeah, disaster.
Horribly awry.
Disaster. Kind of like what we do on the show a lot.
Like when yes. he created, I had him create Thor's hammer as a weapon for the princess. Oops, spoiler alert.
Spoilers.
And so he basically uses it and discovers, oh, you know those governors I should have put on the speed? That sucker broke the sound barrier about 2 meters in front of me. Bad call.
I like that, Thor's hammer. I'm going to have to get the audible version. I have it pulled up. I'm just waiting for my credit to come through. Because I had a baby and we've got a budget, apparently.
Well, you know, all you have to do is just say, hey, Terry, you know, you got an Audible credit? And I'd say, of course I do.
Hold on. hey, Terry, do you have an Audible credit?
You bet. I can cover you.
Score.
You probably have two Audible credits, I imagine. You get 20, I know you get 25 with every book that you put up there.
You had two Audible credits.
moving on from our shameless begging for Audible.
Yes, we beg like beggars on the street. Alms for the poor.
Alms for the poor for our poor hosts.
We've been talking a lot about the characters and the story and the plot. I kind of want to nail down some of the mechanics that you use for your writers, mm-hmm. And some of the process that you go through in your creation. And kind of touching on that real quick is what Preston's asking is, is there a certain point that you know what you need to explain and what you don't need to explain, and an easy way to do that? And in doing so, how do you make it not info dumping? Because I think info dumping in science fiction is a misunderstood concept.
There's a book, and I know I'm give you a chance to kind of ponder your answer, but there's a book called Self-Editing for Writers that talks about telling versus showing, and we all know about that, but it has a nice distinction between like big telling, and a lot of people use small telling, like within a sentence that's not unnecessary, but it also makes a valid point that there are times for narrative summary. And the example they use in that book is like, if you're writing like Friday Night Lights and you have like 15 football games, some of those games are just going to be some quick narrative summary. You're not going to describe every game all the time. And so you don't have to show everything. There's a time and a place to just tell people stuff, in my opinion.
If I'm breaking new ground in the story and I have to explain a concept that is new, the best way I found to do it is to do it while somebody is doing something related to it. Mm-hmm. And you have to have somebody that doesn't know what's going on so that they can go, why is this doing this? Mm-hmm. And have the guy continue doing what he's doing, but toss in enough information to explain what's going on.
Right.
Yeah. No, and there's several different ways to do that. Like I said, you got the scientist messing something up, or you might have the rookie needs to be trained, and I guess kind of what you're saying too, is it has to matter to the story that this information yes. comes out now. And if it matters, then it should be interesting, and then you're good to go.
If you're having to explain something and it doesn't matter the story, you need to ask yourself, why am I saying this now? Why does the reader even need to know?
Because I read the whole Wikipedia page on that subject.
And here's something as writers that we all know, 90% of what we research never makes it into the novel. It might be cool for us to know all these details, but the reader doesn't need to know them.
Right.
Yeah. I was just going to make that point. I think that you do the research and you put the time into it. So damn it, you need to put it in a novel because that it needs to be there and it doesn't. And I like that, that aspect of, I think once you've been doing this for a while and you've written a couple books, you realize that, yeah, I don't need that information in there. And when you read books and you can pick up on the information, you're like, oh, this guy, he just likes to hear himself talk.
Something I discovered when I started writing is that I don't use a lot of descriptive stuff. I tend not to describe what people look like very much. I tend not to describe the scenes a whole lot of what people are seeing. I give just enough detail to give somebody an anchor. And I expected for the first two or three books, I was going to comment, oh God, you can't see any. Nobody ever said a single word about it. So
yeah.
Don't worry that you're not telling them enough. People's imaginations will fill in the blank.
Yeah.
I do the exact same thing. I like, there are certain scenes where I have fun with some really, you know, breathtaking visuals. Cause I like the big panoramic type of scenes or a character that really, but a lot of times it's the same way. I have a couple of books where you would probably not know what race they are at all, because to me, it didn't matter in the story. And sometimes it becomes awkward and stuff, but I like that. And again, if you read romance, I started reading some romance a while back, and it's part of that genre. You have to describe everybody. It's expected. Different genre, different.
It has a different importance in a romance novel, though, because romantic entanglements also have a physical aspect. So it's a lot different.
Right.
And they're all good. Vicky says she loves Yowling Cat Press as a name. Which is good. You know, it's very visual.
It is. And since I have cats, that makes perfect sense.
We haven't talked about tools, Josh.
Let's talk about tools. I'm going to do the ad read first for
need to do that real quick.
Beth, since I don't want to forget this time.
Is awesome, and everybody should know that.
BZ Hercules is a phenomenal editing service. We have partnered with Beth over at BZ Hercules Editing Services to give our listeners and viewers a 15% discount from all her editing and proofing and triangulation, which is basically developmental editing off of her services. You can go to www.bzhercules.com/keystroke-discount.html. We really need to shorten that up or make some kind of a smart URL, because that's a mouthful to say. But anyway,
we could probably do a link on our webpage or something.
Or on but go there. It'll be in the show notes. It'll be in the description below in the episode after it's done airing today. If you need those services, you can get that discount there. Also, Covers for a Cure is coming up next month under 20 days now, I think.
Coming right up.
We are doing a charity event with Tom Edwards for Parkinson's disease. We will be auctioning off 3 Tom Edwards covers on the 8th. And the proceeds from that event will benefit Parkinson's research in partnership with parkinsons.uk.org. So if you are a science fiction author or just want some really cool art by Tom Edwards, you can sign up for that event. Email keystrokemedium@gmail.com with the phrase Covers for a Cure registration in the subject line, and we will get you an invitation to the closed auction, and you will be able to view the entire auction in its entirety on our YouTube channel on the 8th. So with that being said, I did want to talk about the mechanics and the process and the tools. You mentioned dictation earlier, and I'm very curious about dictation. Scott just started up doing it again. Yep. I have dabbled in it occasionally. Can you tell us how you go about doing it? How do you dictate the whole thing and do the open quote, this thing, end quote, comma, new paragraph, and how you got good at that? How long did it take you to really become proficient in the program?
Gosh, I'm not sure that I would still say that I'm proficient. I've actually used it to do a couple of novels so far, and it's still awkward to me. I know I would be faster if I could just turn off the monitor and not try to correct things as I'm going. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't work for my OCD nature. I've got to correct what I see go wrong on the screen. But it's still faster than typing. It averages almost, for me, my typing, I can do around 1,500 words an hour. But dictation, I can get around 2,500 words an hour. And I know that it can get faster as I go along. It's fairly accurate. It does sometimes really screw up, and that's why you have to do another pass to look at it and make sure that you're looking at what it actually said versus what you might have meant, because anything that it puts in there is not going to be caught by a spell check. And that's one of the challenges.
Right. I think, Scott, you were talking about the other day that you were trying to say a specific phrase. I think it was your squadron name, and like on the third try it got it right after you fixed it.
Is that right? It started, I had a big acronym. I had like the UNASMC 95th was a unit name for an armored division, and the first time, and I didn't expect it to ever really figure that out, but I did it because Dragon, you obviously can correct it. I'm using an older version, and it really is, I think if you're going to get really serious about dictation, you need to put in some time to training it and making the corrections. I used to, when I first used it a couple years ago, I had a bad experience with it because I was not looking at the screen at all, and I was just killing it. But the thing is, I didn't correct anything, and so the program didn't get smarter, and it just made the same. And so I'd go back and try to, and I would do like 10,000 words a day. And so at the end of the week, I had 35,000 words of Dragon naturally speaking voice dictation. I read it, and I had to throw away whole pages of stuff that made no sense. I literally couldn't figure out what I was even talking about. but now I kind of watch it, and if I see a word that needs to be corrected, and learning to use the prompts, it seems to work better. And it's even got to the point where it will kind of recognize some of my weird character names.
And it may be counterintuitive, but when you're dictating, if you don't go as fast as your brain wants you to actually talk, if, for example, you talk at about this speed right here, it actually is significantly better for me personally in picking up the words and not screwing them up. Yeah. And it actually goes faster.
And if you say a whole sentence at a time, it works better. Because Dragon figures out what you're saying by the context of the word. So if you're starting and stopping, it can get really slow and clunky.
It also works better for me because I'm a horrible speller. And so when I can say the name, the word, and then dictation goes, bloop, that's what it is. I'm like, that's exactly how I spelled it in my head. Otherwise, I get a whole bunch of red lines all everywhere.
So there's a couple. I know there's actually, I'm actually part of I think it's called Dragon Riders or something.
Dragon Riders, yeah.
Facebook group. Are you in that group?
I am.
Yeah, and so people talk about their different things. So people that are unfamiliar with Dragon Dictation, you have the Mac version, you have the Windows version. You have, like, I'm using Dragon Dictation 12, which is pretty old. So do you have one you use, or have you tried different platforms?
I've got the previous version from the most current. I've used like the last three iterations, 12, 13, and 14. So I've got version 14 professional individual that I'm using on the computer right now. I've thought about buying a recorder. I go out and walk for at least an hour every day. And I've thought about trying to do it while I'm walking and then having the machine go ahead and read that in and put it to text, because some people do that. Yeah. But I just haven't convince myself that that's going to work out for me.
I tried that with my cell phone. There was a Dragon app that you could do that very same thing, and it would transcribe your words. And I could have probably spent more time figuring it out, but I didn't have an easy way to bring the files from my phone over to my computer to have the computer transcribe. And a couple times I did it. I ran into the same problem Scott had, where I was out, I don't know, driving to work at 8 o'clock in the morning or something, and dictating, you know, 2,000 words on my way to work. And then I get home, transcribe it, and then I look at it the next day and I'm like, I don't know what the hell I just said, because it makes no sense whatsoever. But I think that there are, it's besides using your phone, I think you can get, like you're saying, buy an actual audio recorder that is designed to do that, plug it in with the software, and it should theoretically make the process a little bit easier.
So Terry, do you go straight to Word or straight into Scrivener or some other program?
Straight to Word. Mm-hmm. I know that Kevin J. Anderson, he dictates all of his stuff that he writes. He doesn't use Dragon. He actually sends the files off to someone to transcribe them But that's how he can write as much as he does, is he goes for a hike every day and he dictates his novels.
Yeah.
I want to be him when I grow up.
Professional transcriptions would be fantastic. I would love that.
Scott, can you be my professional transcriptionist, please?
I can't spell any better than you can. So it would just get, it'd be like bad spelling plus bad spelling equals horrible spelling,
It's not like a self-correcting thing?
Yeah, so Vicky says you'll be that crazy guy walking a dog down the street talking to himself.
You know, you could actually just stand on the street corner with some post-apocalyptic sign and be dictating your science fiction novel, and no one would ever know.
They wouldn't be like, this guy right here. The laser blast shot through the hull of the ship and destroyed it.
Mm-hmm. They'd just think you're crazy and go on about their way.
They'd walk right past you, kind of like when Joshua Bell played his Stradivarius violin in the New York subway, and people just walked by him like it was nothing. You know, right. The world's greatest violinist playing a $10 million violin. And people walk by him like he's just another guy on the street playing. But people are busy. They got things to do. I'm not going to cast stones because I probably would have pushed him out of the way.
Speaking of developing your product, and now we've talked a little bit about how you create and write. You are indie published, and you have been, I think, since you started.
That's right.
Can we talk a little bit about... what I think is an overlooked topic, and we try not to overlook it on the show, but I think a lot of writers do. And that's the topic of covers and how to present a good cover. I really like your covers because they are obviously science fiction covers. They're obviously, in the same realm of David Weber and John Ringo, like you said, those type of covers. Do you have an artist that does them, or is this something that you've done on your own?
My wife actually puts the covers together because she's better at it than I. We went to a workshop that part of it talked about cover creation, and actually went through the design elements, everything from how fonts are used, how images are laid out, what people are actually looking for in a cover, whether they subconsciously know it or consciously know it. And we've taken that and brought it home, and we're using it to build our covers with, because covers are a marketing tool. And it took me the longest time to learn that what is on it doesn't necessarily have to be explicitly inside it.
Right.
Because you're not making a promise of what's inside the book. You're just identifying what genre and what the reader is going to be getting. If you're true to that, you can go to places like Deposit Photos and buy stock art that will work just fine for what you're doing.
Right. And that being said, just buying stock art and using it isn't enough. I think that you can look at your covers and say, yeah, okay, you have put some work and some time and thought into it. Vicky Malone Kennedy says, does your wife use a specific program for the cover design?
She does portions of it in Photoshop and other portions in InDesign. I'm not sure which parts are which. She does her magic. She's taken the spaceship that I used for the primary ship on this cover, taken it out of the original piece of art, and it gets transplanted and transposed into other stuff to make it work. And she does the twitching on the various layers to make the colors come out the way they do to get the right contrast. It's magic.
Yeah. It's magic.
It looks great, and that is really important because nothing's more awkward than throwing up a stock art cover and then everybody else is using the same one. But you got
to
take the elements out, like you said, and kind of make it. Or Josh was saying, there's some design issues with it.
So. A lot of authors don't realize that they've got to have good covers, really good covers, to get somebody to actually see them. Then they've got to have a good blurb to go along with it.
Right.
And those two things together are going to get you to get people to buy your books.
And then a good book will get them to buy the next book.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
I like that you mentioned the blurb, because I think that is also the number two most overlooked thing is the blurb. Can you talk about what you've done to create a sellable or attractive blurb for your books?
My original blurbs I thought were okay, but people have told me they basically sucked. So I went ahead and took an online course to learn how to write sales copy for writers. And it cost $300, but it was worth it in the end because I got feedback and I learned a lot about how to go ahead and put together different types of active sales copy. There's a video on the internet called Five Guys in a Limo, and it's old, but it's got, you know, five big voice artists speaking in active voice because you've got to avoid that passive voice
right
inside your sales copy. And it's a great place to start to learn how movie people talk. And it may sound silly to write your blurbs actively like that, but it actually does make a big difference to people that are reading it. And don't do something called the author problem. When you're writing your blurb, don't say, and this happened, and this happened, and this happened. Set up enough to where they know what kind of story they're getting. Don't tell them the story. That's what the book is for.
Right. It comes out like an outline or a synopsis. It's not necessarily a synopsis. It's more of a sales synopsis, maybe. But you can tell that a lot of writers, it's so funny because you spend, you know, hundreds of hours writing your novel and then you get stuck writing the little 500 word blurb. It's like, feels impossible sometimes.
It's because people try to summarize and they're still in writing fiction mode when they're writing the sales copy, when it's not the same thing. And most people don't even realize that it's not the same thing.
Right.
We had two questions come in as we started talking about blurb that referenced back to what we were talking about with covers that I'd like to touch really quick. Mm-hmm. Vicky Malone Kennedy asks, does your wife do covers for other authors? And then Preston asks, how do you decide what you want to be on your cover?
My wife has done some covers for other people, but she's disabled, so she doesn't do very much. I think I pretty much fill most of her time cover wise, and she hates it because I'm a picky customer. What can I say? But you can always ask her, but I don't know how much time she would have. What was the second question?
I'm sorry. How do you decide what you want to be on your covers?
Oh, that's always a challenge when I'm doing the covers. I'll tell my wife in general terms what I'm looking for. She'll put something together and I'll go, it's completely wrong. And then we go through the fight back and forth about putting what elements I want in there.
One of the only times you can get away with telling your wife you're wrong.
I don't exactly get away with it. No.
I pretend like I do.
Yeah.
I have this elaborate fantasy world where I'm right.
One thing that I try to do, and that I'm all too bad at actually making it happen, is I should look at images before I start and say, this is the kind of cover I think I would like to have for the story, and then write the story that would fit that cover. But it never works out that way. The cover is always the last thing.
Right.
I have a problem going to sites where they have pre-made covers. I'm like, oh, I'm going to write a book about that. I'm going to write a book about that. And then I get down all of about 50 rabbit trails and get nothing done. But that's there, go there. But I find art very inspiring. You know, mm-hmm. There's lots of things that inspire you, music, art, other books, people, life experiences and things like that. But art is definitely a big one. I'm a very visual person. So
we are coming close to the hour for the show. Preston has a question about marketing that I don't think we've touched on during our conversation at all. What's your favorite type of marketing, or do you have a favorite type? And then I'll add on to that from Preston's question. Have you noticed if any certain type of marketing that you do works better than others?
The best marketing you can do for your book is to write the next book. That is the absolute best thing that you can do. As far as actually getting people to come back and get that next book, if you go ahead and create a mailing list and you put that mailing list link in your novels where you're listing your other titles, I put it at the beginning of my book, and it's the first thing you see when you get to the last word of the story is go here to sign up for my mailing list. You'll only be notified of new books. You won't get spammed, that kind of thing. And that mailing list is what built my career. Being a good writer helped, but getting people that found it and said, you know, I'd like to hear more about it the next time one comes out, has what's made this sustainable. In the course of 10 books, it's gotten to where there's 1,200 people on my mailing list. I don't give anything away. So these are people that actually want to hear about the next book. If you can build that kind of list and it starts slowly and it grows as you do it, that is the absolute best thing you can do for yourself as an author, to help people find you again when they've loved you the first time.
And I'd like to ask too, because I think a lot of our audience are just getting started in their writing career or in their publishing journey. You say the best marketing is to write the next book and then to create the email list. What is your advice for someone that's just starting out, or if there's something that you've learned now after doing it for so long, just starting out, you know, what do you do with the mailing list as soon as you start out, or when you only have that first book out, is there any marketing or anything that you can do while you're writing the second book that will help?
I would say you could do some things. You could mention it on Facebook, but when you've only got one book out, your exposure is going to be limited. Through experience, I've found that if you're writing a series, until you hit about book three, you don't start building as fast as you might want to. There was definitely a spot when I published book three in the series, things definitely went up from there. And when you're just starting out, you just have to accept that things are not going to be where you would want them to be. Just keep writing that next book. Keep writing the one after that, because this is not a foot race. It's a marathon. You're just going to keep putting out book after book after book. Don't worry that any specific single one doesn't do as well as you might like it to do. It's going to find its day in the sun, or maybe it won't. You just have to go ahead and create a product, put it out there, move on.
Yeah, no, that's great. I mean, I recently did a pen name, and I published one book with no backlist and really no social media presence. And I remembered the days of starting out with the first book. I was like, this is horrible. How did I ever keep going? You know, but really, I think you're right. I think just you got to keep producing that product. It makes it so much easier to have multiples. Advice we've had people take in the past is, like you said, do the social media. There's some promo sites you can use, but you need to get to having some more backlist pretty quickly, I think.
Something that I'm going to experiment going forward is I'm going to experiment with Amazon ads. I'm going to experiment with Facebook ads for the new release for maybe like a week. The Amazon ads would be like for book one or maybe book two of the series, to try to bring people in to start the series. But yeah, I've never tried them. I've heard other people say that they've made a huge difference, but I've never done it.
Have you used any type of paid ads?
No. Well, actually, that's not true. I did a Book Barbarian once. And it got a lot of free copies out for that. And maybe that helped, but not that I could really tell. And I've heard that BookBub used to be really great, but it's getting less so. I don't know. It's also very expensive.
Hard to get into BookBub. I mean, if you don't have 100 book reviews and a super nice cover, then you're probably going to have a hard time getting into BookBub's mailing list. That's fascinating. So we'll have to have a whole nother show about that, because now I'm all excited and interested, and I got like a million questions to ask you about marketing and how you got there. But you're obviously doing very well. You got tons of reviews on your books. So excellent.
Thank you.
So as we wrap up and kind of wind down the show today, do you have any goals or any projects that are coming this year that you'd like to mention or talk about? What do you have going on in your writing career this year?
My writing career this year, I'm trying to up my output. Last year I did 5 books. I'm trying to double it this year. We'll see how well that works out for me. If I even get 8 books, I'll be thrilled by how that worked out. I've got a new release in my main series coming next month. That's about it. Just keep plugging away. It's got so many things on my schedule that it's just one thing after another.
You got to keep on pushing.
And if there is, if audiences are wanting to find out more about you and your books, do you have a Twitter, Facebook, website?
I use Facebook. I'm there all the time. I'm very active there. The podcast, the Dead Robot Society, also has a Facebook group where a bunch of writers go and do talking about various things. I'm active there as well. And you can find me on the Dead Robot Society podcast every week too.
What's the website for that?
DeadRobotSociety.com. 2 S's. Robots Society. It's a trick.
We'll leave a link to all those sites in the show notes. and in the description of this video once it's finalized. So, well, thank you so much, Terry, for hanging out with us on live today. We really appreciate it, taking the time out to talk with us and our audience. Everybody in the Keytruck Medium chat, remember what happens in KSM chat stays in KSM chat. And thank you guys for coming and hanging out with us. It's been a great hour, a very active hour.
I'm very Terry, excited to go look at the Empire Bones series. I'm fascinated by your description of that story verse. So
it is unique and it's very good in my most humble opinion.
Awesome. Just go out to my Amazon page and you'll see all the various books I've got written there.
Sweet.
Awesome. Well, Terry, thanks again for coming and hanging out with us. We have had a blast on the show. For everybody that's watching, thank you for hanging out with us. If you haven't subscribed to the channel, please subscribe. Give us a little thumbs up. Let us know if you have any ideas about future guests or future topics you'd like to hear about. For Scott Moon, I am Josh Hayes, and we have been live with Terry Mixon on this Monday morning. Make sure you come back next week where we're talking about reading, writing, and everything in between right here on Keystroke Medium. You guys take it easy.
Thanks.